Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Well, the solstice for the winter occurs on December 21st. And with that, I will take a look ahead at what's coming in the next season. So during winter, and a lot of people think, oh, winter's not a good time because it's cold. Au contraire, it's actually a great time to go outside because it's darker for longer. The sky very often has less moisture in it, so you can see more. Plus, there's stuff that you can see in the sky in the winter that you can't see in the summer. So take advantage of it. Just make sure you bundle up to do so. Let's see what's going to be happening in the sky over in the western part of the sky towards this time of winter. The summer triangle is still hanging around, but it's just about gone. There's Altair way down by the western horizon. Deneb and Vega are not far behind. So what we really have left overhead is what I like to think of as more of kind of the autumn constellations. So there's Pegasus here. There is Aquarius way down here. If you've got some darker skies, you might be able to pick that out along with Pisces. Cetus is towards the south. And then brighter ones would be Andromeda and Cassiopeia and Perseus. And there's some great targets to see in those areas where there's a lot of open clusters, particularly in Cassiopeia. Definitely look for that. And then the winter constellations are starting to rise. And this is still at 7:45. So actually, if you even just wait a couple hours, we go ahead a couple hours, all those come up by like 11 o'clock. So you'll have the winter constellations as well. See, that's why there's more things that you can see in the winter for longer periods of time. You'd have to wait just that long just to see stuff in the summer. So if we go back to that time, I want to show you what Mars is going to do over the days and months ahead. Watch how it just sort of sits there. It doesn't really go anywhere. So a month on, it's still sitting kind of in that same part of the sky. And then if we go another month and look what happens, it's still just kind of sitting there, not really going anywhere. Now the problem is it doesn't really get much brighter. If anything, it's getting dimmer because it started out, actually, I'm going to go back real quickly. You can see it started out at magnitude 0.3, and then as we go ahead, it goes to 0.75 and then down to 1.1. And then when we go another full month on, it actually is going to drop down to about 1 point, just under 1.3. So it gets quite dim and it also gets much smaller. It started out at like 8 arc seconds across. Now it's going to be like 4.8 arc seconds across, which is really small. You won't be able to see a whole lot of detail. You'd have to have pretty steady skies and a lot of magnification to maybe see the polar cap, and you might see a couple dark markings, but that's it, not much more. So, where are all the planets? Well, we can find those. They are actually over in the morning sky. So, let's kind of look at what's happening over there in the eastern part of the sky way early in the morning. Right before sunrise, you can see Venus is sitting there. Let me back up just an hour right here, and then we watch what happens with these. Actually, on January 6th, Venus will be at greatest western elongation. That's its furthest point west in the sky before it starts dropping back towards the sun. And you can see that Jupiter is climbing towards it. And as we get a little bit further into January, those two are going to be really close to each other towards the latter part of the month. Those are the two brightest planets. Those are the two brightest objects in the sky after the sun and moon. So to see those next to each other is going to be really quite a sight. And they're very close to each other. So definitely check that out late in the month. Then later on, as we keep going, Saturn then joins Venus in late February. And those two planets will kind of march their way across the sky as Venus starts to drop down in the morning. But we can even go back to a little bit of what's happening in the evening sky. Towards the beginning of January, the Quadrantids meteor shower, which is kind of a section of the sky near Ursa Major, will have one of the best meteor showers besides the Geminids. And a lot of people think the Perseids in August are the best. They're really not. The Geminids and the Quadrantids are probably the best too. They can produce the most meteors. So if it's warm enough and clear enough, go outside if you can and check that out because that should be a pretty good apparition because you notice there's not really a moon that will be at issue pretty much that entire night. So if you got moon-free skies, it makes it even better to be able to see meteors as well. On January 21st, and I will definitely be doing an Eyes on the Sky video about this, there is a total lunar eclipse that will be occurring. And most of the people who view me in North America and Europe, will be able to see this event. And you can see that even Stellarium shows this event as it would be occurring. So I'm gonna center that and then zoom in. And as we go through that night here, so this will actually start on the 20th. And as we go forward in time, you can watch and see how the penumbra starts to cover the moon, and then later on, the umbra will cover the moon as well. That's the deepest part of the shadow. And the great thing about this one is that it lasts a really long time. It's over an hour long for that particular eclipse. So I will definitely have more information about that one coming up. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.